Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. John's Westminster. We welcome everyone who's here in person. And those of you who are watching us online or on YouTube, we welcome you too. I have lots of announcements, so get ready. Today is the deadline to order poinsettias to decorate the sanctuary for the Christmas Eve service. The envelopes are on the snack table in the narthex. No, they're not. Where are they, Judy? They're gone, so they've all been ordered. Okay, if you want to order a poinsettia and you haven't yet, then see Judy after church. This week, on Thursday the 7th, it's our amazing PJ with Santa party and a special presentation with Santa. We'll be having refreshments, crafts, and other activities, and the Scholastic Book Fair. So if you want to come and pick out books for any kids that you have in your family, that'd be wonderful. You can join in with the party and see the excitement of all the kids who are there and get some books in the process. We need some volunteers, so if you can come, see Heidi. We have four names left from the Christmas draw for Christmas gifts for children in need. Please help make Christmas special for a teen or a child. Pick a name from the tree on the church bulletin board. All gifts between $20 and $25 should be wrapped, tagged, and delivered to church on or before Tuesday, December 12th. The lunch bunch is coming up. It's going to meet December 12th at La Rosa's on Budino. If you plan to attend, let me know, and we'll keep count. We have a lot more to go. Please sign up on the sheet in the narthex for the winter solstice service on December 21st at 6 p.m. If you plan to attend, so that we can see if there is enough interest to plan the service. How many people do we have to have, Alan, before you're going to go ahead with the service?
We need at least six more people.
Okay, we need at least six more people, so let's get signed up. The solstice service is usually done with participants gathered in a circle around a table decorated with symbols of light. Candles are lit in remembrance of beloved friends and as signs of prayer and thankfulness as well. It's a time for healing and renewal in the midst of this dark night, with a joyful recognition that every day that follows the solstice is brighter than the day before until summer comes again. Check out the article that's in the Life, and if you want to discuss it with Pastor Allen, he's here after church. You can ask him. Okay, the Christmas Joy Christmas Fund special offering will be received on Sunday, December 24th. And as usual, it will be divided between the UCC and the PCUSA denominations. What this special offering does is provide assistance to active and retired clergy and lay employees of the UCC and the PCUSA in their time of need. There's a bulletin insert. Read it. Learn more about it. Share the warmth. We're collecting new gloves, hats, mittens, scarves, and fleece blankets, no stretchy gloves, in the receptacle outside the church, and we also have the collection point over here in the narthex. Invite your friends and neighbors to donate. As in past years, Christmas for Jesus Poor will receive the warm items. I placed this item on the Delhi Facebook community page, and we've received community donations already from that posting. So, you know, it's a community activity, and we're happy to have everyone in the Delhi area or in the viewing audience to join us in helping provide warm items for Jesus's poor. Alice wants everyone to know that she put out the files in the narthex for Christmas cards. So if you want to drop a Christmas card in for someone who comes to church on Sundays here, feel free to do that. We're doing that. And I would like everyone to look at these lovely new pyramids that Worship and Arts has purchased. The old ones were in disrepair, and these are lovely as well as reversible. So it's the 2-for-1 special. All right. Now, finally, I think the announcements are over. So please join me for the call to worship. Surely God is our salvation. We will trust and will not be afraid, for the Holy One is our strength and our might and has become our salvation. With joy we will draw water from the wells of salvation and give thanks to God. We call upon God's name, make known your deeds among the nations. Sing praises to God, for God's deeds are glorious. For great in our midst is the Holy One. May I have members of council session come up, and we're going to light our Advent wreath with the first candle of Advent. This is such a good group of people to belong to. It's my comment for the morning. This is the promise given by Paul to the church at Rome. You know what hour it is, how it is full time now for you to wake from sleep, for salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is far gone, the day is at hand. Let us then cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Today we light the candle of hope on our Advent wreath. Gracious God, we live within your promises that cast a spell upon the night of doubt and sorrow in our lives. May the hope you have given us, nurtured in your love, be the new reality that wakens us each day, so that we may share your dreams and find the truth of your holy way.
Good will to all from highest heaven.
Our reading from the Hebrew Scriptures today comes from Isaiah chapter 64, verses 1 through 9, and I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Edition. Hear God's word as I share it with you. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes the water to boil. To make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways, but you were angry and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, like we say, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Listen now for God's word to you in this reading of the gospel lesson. These are the words of Jesus speaking in an apocalyptic way, speaking about last things, about the ultimate judgments of God. But in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the from heaven, the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory.
Then he will send out the angels and gather the elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that the summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be aware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight, or at cockcrow or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. Here ends the reading of the gospel lesson. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Grace be unto you and peace from God and from our Savior, Jesus, who is the Christ. Oh, that bustling season is upon us, isn't it? That time when everybody is filling the stores and it seems like the traffic on the highways is increasing and people are always going somewhere to get something for somebody. And everybody seems very, very busy. You know, people will ask me sometimes, are you ready for Halloween? Are you ready for Thanksgiving? Are you ready for Christmas? But nobody ever asks me, are you ready for Advent? Why is that? Because it's the season that seems like it's between the holidays, the Thanksgiving holiday and the Christmas holiday. In the secular world, that's the way it is. And we want somehow to move them closer together. So we went, my wife and I went on the day before Thanksgiving. We had gotten some little things, some chocolate turkeys and some little finger puppets for our great-grandchildren for Thanksgiving, for the dinner we were having. And we decided at the last minute, on the day before Thanksgiving, we'd run to the store and get little boxes for them. We went to Dollar Tree, because they always have lots of little boxes at Dollar Tree. It's a good place to go for that. We went in looking for the Thanksgiving stuff, and it was gone, completely gone, because Christmas had come to Dollar Tree. We have to go through this season of being ahead of time all the time, as though we can barely wait to get there. Well, in some ways, no wonder that's so, because we might feel like we need Christmas a little earlier this year. I think about the wonderful words of the prophet Isaiah. He was speaking about the Babylonian captivity. He was speaking about the oppression that was upon the people. And as a prophet, Isaiah wanted people to know that they had a responsibility for the state they were in. And the state they were in was not good. So he begins this section of his book, of prophecy by saying to God, oh, why can't you just come break open heaven and come down and be with us in this time of great need? And that same prayer toward the end of the reading, if you heard it, he says, just remake us. You're the one who made us in the very beginning. You're the one who molded us from the earth. Take us up again, be our potter, and we will be the clay in your hands. Mold us new and make it like it was. When we think about the wars and the violence, the children who are harmed, and the fears we have about our world today, don't we kind of want God to come down out of heaven and make us new as well? Well, Advent in the Christian community is the time of the year when we think about starting out new again. The season carries with it the assumption that people get tired and need rejuvenation, that people get cynical and need to find something to believe in, that people get tired of waiting and want to see the light at the end of the tunnel, that people get lost and need to find the way again. It's not an accident that Advent season occurs in the Christian church as we become conscious of the growing cold and darkness of winter. And it seems like a bit of grace when we enter this season at the end of a year that's had its share of sorrow and misfortune. Not that we're all unhappy, but there is among us much that is troubling. As we enter the month of December, our nation is the reluctant participation in two violent and devastating wars. We're worried about how the growing threats of climate change will affect our children's lives. Our faith in our beloved democracy is being undercut by some of the worst political misbehavior that we've seen in our lifetimes. And with all of this, we see a weakening in the religious institutions that provide strength and comfort to us as people of faith. A person could be feeling a little down. And sometimes, when I'm feeling a little frustrated and the news of the world takes hold of me and I begin to dwell upon it, a silly theme song comes running through my head. That happened to you as you're contemplating the world around you, that sometimes a tune strikes in your mind and it keeps going over and over and over again. Well, the one I have for this season is from an old Broadway musical called Auntie Mame. And I remember that in the particular scene that the song comes from, everything in the story was going wrong that year. For Mame, who is the lead character in the story, and the people in her household. Finances were bad, relationships were bad, the news was bad, and Mame, who was played by Rosalind Russell in the version I saw in film, in that version she suddenly shouted and began then to sing, "We need a little Christmas right this very minute. Holly in the window, carols on the spinet." I'd sing it for you if I had a decent voice, but I don't. But it's through my head all the time. And immediately, all the trouble and sadness was washed away. For the moment, there was singing, there was dancing, there was not a little alcohol being consumed. And it seemed as though the problems were all gone for a time. What do you think? Do we need a little Christmas? When I was a child growing up in Chicago in a not very religious family, I knew exactly where Christmas was. For better or worse, it was not in church for me, but it was definitely religious nonetheless. It was on the sixth floor of Marshall Field and Company on State Street in Chicago, the old store. That was the era of the great department stores with all their wonderful floors of merchandise. On the first floor, there were the men's ties and accessories and women's jewelry and perfume, and then clothing on the second. On the third were the stamps, the coins, and the books, a whole floor for those things, and a great waiting room as well. And then there were other things that I wasn't much interested in, you know, the pots and the pans, things like that. And then there was the sixth floor, an entire block full of nothing but children's toys. That's all there was there. And it was not uncommon in those days, though it seems funny to us now, that a child would be allowed to walk for hours unaccompanied on the sixth floor in the midst of the toy department of Marshall Fields while our mothers were down on another floor trying dresses on or something. And any worries or traumas would completely melt away. And time itself would be forgotten. Wouldn't you like to have a little Christmas? But then, you know, there comes the inevitable return, the crash, the return to the hard realities of life. For those who didn't see the movie or the play, Auntie Mame's Christmas party was followed by a terrible hangover. And her housekeeper found herself pregnant, and she didn't know how she got that way. And the truth is that I never got anything, got everything I saw and wanted for Christmas at Marshall Fields. Though, truth be told, I got quite a bit. But it was disappointing, nonetheless, that I didn't get everything. Because what child doesn't want everything? And maybe there's more truth than we ever imagined to the notion that the Advent season just might hold some spiritual secrets of its own that have the capacity to fill us up a little bit better than even those joyful Christmas early moments. And that can bring joy to our hearts that no amount of escapist pleasure can offer. If we give Advent, it's time. Advent, in its truest form, is a Sabbath time for our souls, a time to learn, to grow, and examine ourselves and our place in the world, and to prepare ourselves for Christ's coming, not just at Christmas, but possibly every day. Since every day does hold the opportunity for us to encounter the Christ of life's deeper meaning. Not just to remember a holy infant who was born on Christmas morning, or wait for him to return at the end of time, which seems to be endless, but to discern again today the living spirit of the one who showed us how to love and how to live in peace in the midst of the dangers and challenges of this present time. What are you doing for Advent this year? People often ask, what are you doing Christmas Eve? What are you doing New Year's Eve? I'm going to ask the other question, what are you doing for Advent this year? How will you allow this sacred season to prepare you to greet the Christ made flesh each day as we see him incarnate in the people we meet in our daily lives? Advent is a season of prophecy. We read about a prophet of Israel named Isaiah, speaking both warnings and promises in the era of oppression under the Empire of Babylon. And we read about a radical preacher named John, waist deep in the Jordan River, drowning people to their sins. Or we read about a young man named Jesus, known as a sage, telling in a dark imperial time about a kingdom made in heaven that is coming soon. In our world today, prophecy is often thought of as though it were fortune telling, the gift of knowing what will happen before it does. But the gift of prophecy in the scriptures has a different meaning from that. The purpose of prophecy in the Bible is not to predict what is going to happen before it does, but to help us discern the paths our lives are taking based upon an honest assessment of the truth about how we're caring for one another and for our world. Prophets remind us about those who are suffering when most of us are feeling pretty good. And in disappointing times, prophets lead us toward finding the way to reconciliation and peace and having our lives remolded by God. In the Hebrew scriptures, Moses is a prophet. The first prophecy that he uttered was that God willed God's people to be free so that they could be witnesses to the law of God and the blessing to all the earth. Moses gave the people the Torah, the law of God, and the prophets who followed him measured the actions of the people and their leaders against the teachings of that law. When the prophets saw that people were misusing the land, gaining wealth by oppressing the poor, worshiping the gods of greed, cheating people in business, refusing hospitality to immigrants, or any such moral crimes that are all listed in the scriptures, the prophet's job was to tell the truth, accompanied by a warning about the violence and disorder that would ensue if justice did not prevail. And when the consequences of their failure to care about one another, and especially the neediest among them, came to pass, the prophet would call the people to repentance and offer them the hope of the faithful promises of God. You are our potter. Mold us over and make us new as it was in the beginning. Over the years, the church has mostly thought of Jesus as our Savior and as a human likeness of God, whose love is so deep that he suffers for the sins of all the world. That's a treasured and valuable teaching. But in Jesus' day, nobody came to that conclusion just by watching him die on a cross. There were far too many people dying on crosses for that to be so. During Jesus' life in Palestine, 2 millennia ago, people saw him as a sage. A sage is someone who interprets the tradition of God's people to every new generation. And they saw him as a healer. A healer is a person who restores health and wholeness to a community of people. And they saw him as a prophet. As a prophet, Jesus saw the excesses and the injustices of his time. The collaboration and the timidity of religious leaders who did not speak out against the authoritarian state. And the tendency of people to pick at minor human failings while neglecting the broader themes of justice, reconciliation, and love. From the very beginning, after Jesus died, his followers believed that his spirit lived within them. They formed communities where they applied a simple true rule of practice that became a witness to their neighbors. They practiced hospitality, welcoming everybody, even strangers and foreigners and erstwhile enemies, sharing their wealth and possessions to make sure that everyone had enough. They refused to practice violence, even as they put themselves in danger by speaking against the injustices of the empire. They committed themselves to trust in God and be worthy of one another's trust. And they set aside a day each week when they would care for the health of their spirits and grow in faithfulness. These are the practices of Advent. The early church members felt a spiritual peace in their lives because of these practices, even when they encountered great opposition, as they did all the time. They felt they were showing the world a way to live that overcomes the motives of fear and anger and the behaviors of indifference or exploitation, those things that infect our human societies. And they said that this way of living was based on Christ's vision of a realm of justice that God desires for us all. The powers of this world have never trusted such a vision. But we who believe are heirs of the vision, and in this faith we believe we experience the presence and the peace of Christ. And that is the joy of Advent. So, my dear, tired Advent companions, if we're looking a little worse for the wear this season, like Auntie Mame in the Broadway play, we may think we need a little Christmas right this very minute. And that's all right. We probably do, for a moment at least. And I would encourage us all to be kind and tolerant of one another, because faith fails in all of us sometimes. Just let's remember to take some time this season to work on our own soul's preparation. We believe that we are followers of the most compassionate person who ever lived, and that he gave us a vision about how the world should be and invited us to pursue that vision courageously with him. If we do so, he promised to be with us and to grant us a kind of peace that the world cannot fully comprehend. So let us do the work of Advent. Seek justice for the dispossessed. Care for those who need healing. Welcome the stranger. And share what we have with those in need. Because soon, the work of Advent becomes the very spirit of Christmas that we're seeking. Amen. I invite you to share with me in our affirmation of faith. Let us rise. What is your only comfort in life and in death? I belong, body and soul, in life and in death, not to myself, but to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ, who at the cost of his own blood has fully paid for all my sins and has completely freed me from the dominion of the devil, that he protects me so well that without the will of my Father in heaven, not a hair can fall from my head. Indeed, that everything must fit his purpose for my salvation. Therefore, by his Holy Spirit, he also assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. Let us receive our morning offering. Let us join in prayer. God, we lay before you these our gifts, made holy as they are shared and used in faithfulness and care. Amen. Welcome to the table of Christ's presence. In our fellowship, we practice what we believe that Jesus taught, that all are welcome at this meal, that no one is excluded for any reason. We welcome you to share in this meal with us. And if there are those of you who are observing our communion service at home, we hope that you know that you are welcome with us. We know that you are there. We care about you and pray with you and for you. And we invite you to share communion with us as well. If you need a little time, hit the pause button. It's wonderful that we have those things these days. And go and find some food, some drink that will serve as communion for you. And then return. And we'll wait for you. Jesus is said to have created this sacred meal. And we usually think about it as the meal of his Last Supper with his disciples in the upper room. But in fact, didn't Jesus throughout his entire life and ministry share food? Story after story tells us. He shared it on the hillside with people who hadn't brought enough and miraculously found enough among them to feed an entire crowd. He had meals that were criticized by others because they were so inclusive. He kept inviting people that nobody wanted to have in their home to have a meal with him. He might have included you and me in those gatherings. No qualifications. We're welcome at the meal that Christ created. We celebrate the meal also because he said that in these elements of bread and wine, we could find in partaking of them him incarnate in our midst. That doesn't just mean in the bread and the wine, which are symbols of that, but in you and me. So that we understand that practicing Advent is developing the relationship with one another, not only in this room and among those watching on television, but with everyone incarnate, the Spirit of Christ. Just as Jesus said it in our reading last week, remember it? The final judgment scene? He said, if you did it to the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you did it to me. So this meal is the symbol by which we gather and declare that Christ is present among us, that we know him here, that we know him in all our relatedness. Will you join me in prayer? Gracious God, as we begin the journey of Advent, may we find that the packing we have done and the mapping of our trip will suit us well for the day of Christ's coming. May the belongings we take along be gifts to share, so that our baggage becomes lighter each day. May this holy season, God, prepare us for life in a community of hope as we recommit ourselves to the calling we share in the fellowship of Christ. We pray for those in our congregation who are ill or shut in, for those experiencing loneliness and separation, and for those who long for the touch of others. Remind us all of our calling to be caregivers to any who may need the gift of our presence. We pray for our church and our partners in the community as we seek to bring ministry to all of our neighbors, especially in this Advent season as we look forward to Christmas. May our offerings be blessed by your favor and used for ministries in accordance with your will. We lift up before you the victims of war in Ukraine, in Gaza, and in Israel, remembering especially the children and all who are innocent victims of inhumanity. May the nations learn the ways of peace that begin with justice and seek reconciliation. And may we in our own small communities do all that is in our power to express the love that Jesus taught for people of all social, ethnic, and religious backgrounds. Remove, God, the impulse toward violence within us and within our society. Be with us on the journey, God, and hear us as we seek your guidance in the often confusing wilderness of our day. Today, God, we thank you for this holy meal of remembrance and thanksgiving, this holy meal of fellowship where all are welcome. We thank you, God, for your presence among us and your presence in this sacramental time and in these elements of bread and wine. And now we pray in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night on which he was betrayed, our Lord took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Drink of it, all of you. Do this in remembrance of me." "Come unto me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Take and eat. This cup is the new covenant in the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is shed for you for the remission of sin. Take and drink. Do this in remembrance of him.
Thank you.
take and drink. May the Holy Communion of the Body and Blood of Jesus Christ our Lord be and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. Depart in peace. We give you thanks, O Holy God, for this your sacrament of grace, for the wonder of your love and your presence with us to the end of time. Amen. Bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.